Hello, in this video I will show you how I solved a challenge from ALLES CTF created by a YouTuber who you probably know, LiveOverflow. The solution involved multiple steps and make sure to watch the video until the end because I used a method that allowed me to get the first blood on the challenge because I was able to exfiltrate the flag 95% faster than the naive solution. And that number is not a bait, it's an actual calculation. You will see for yourself. If it's your first time here, my name is Greg, and here on YouTube I explained advanced hacking techniques used in bug bounty reports. I also have a podcast and a newsletter, both free and paid. To fully understand my solution to the challenge, you should first watch a video on LiveOverflow's channel where he explains how the challenge is built and what are the components. I will mainly focus on hacking it. Right now, click the card or link in the description to watch that video. I think he's a guy that doesn't need introduction, but in case you missed it, he's a YouTuber with over 600,000 subscribers and over 300 public IT security videos. There's a whole range of topics covered, from web security through CTFs to low-level and even hardware exploitation. If you are not subscribed or YouTube does no longer recommend you his videos, check out tons of free, high-quality content. Did you watch it already? I hope yes, so we can go ahead with the walkthrough. Let's quickly see what the application does. There are two separate directories. First, I took a look at the app itself. When seeing the source code, I did not spend too much time on those helper functions. Instead, I went straight down to controllers. In most of them, queries are executed using prepared statements. It means that the application knows those parameters are not trusted and SQL injection won't happen in them, unless, of course, there's a bug in the library. However, in one function, there is a query created the unsafe way. The prepared statement is used, but the order argument is not a statement's parameter. Python creates the string before even calling querydb. The function considers this string as trusted, including the order param, which is controlled by the user. Every time that there is just one place where something is done differently is a good lead. Of course, there is a chance that cheeky LiveOverflow planted this as a red herring, but one way or another, I had to check this. I launched the application locally. I quickly confirmed SQL injection by using asts limit 0 and I saw no nodes. It meant that my limit clause was present in the SQL query and it returned 0 rows. Then I tried with the union. However, I got blocked by Web Application Firewall. At this point, I had to understand the relationship between the two applications. If you did watch LiveOverflow's video, you know it. The decryptor works like a reverse proxy and the app itself is not exposed. I found that out by examining contents of Docker files. Inside the source code, there is only one controller which forwards the requests to the app. But before doing that, the WAF param function was called on all the parameters. Its logic was very simple. It filtered only a few words or characters. Those included select, union, and quotes. It's a short list, but it seemed quite convenient to me. There was also no unusual things that could open a way to more advanced attacks. So I wanted to find a way to smuggle my parameters without entering this function. I spent some time here by trying to find bypasses using those unfiltered values like content type header or cookie header, but I didn't come up with anything smart. Then I thought about spending a bit more time on the way those URLs are created. Anytime I see an address just concatenated like this, I feel like something might be off. And I was right this time. The path variable is a URL parameter. There are no explicit transformations here, but Flask automatically decodes it. So if I used a path with URL encoded question mark, then the request was sent with the question mark decoded. The reverse proxy didn't consider those to be parameters, but rather a part of the path. So this way, I was able to smuggle my payloads bypassing the WAF. Note the ampersand at the end. It's important because if it wasn't there, the question mark would be treated as the part of the parameter, breaking my SQL query. I confirmed that this bypass works and I was ready to create the exploit. I took a look into where the flag is. It was added as the first node. I wanted to use SQL map for that because it's much faster when it comes to exfiltrating data. But I couldn't configure it to work with my specific case where the payload was the part of the path. I didn't think creating tamper script would help either. Modifying the source code was an option that I considered, but I opted to write my own exploit instead. The first step is determining what query to use to extract the flag. Testing this on a running web app would be a very inefficient way, even if it was running locally. I would have to make additional effort in order not to break encoding. Instead, I took an advantage of the fact that this is an open source task. I just copied the database file from the Docker container and started testing different queries. At this point, I noticed that there is no plaintext flag in the database. Instead, it's encrypted. Considering the name of the challenge, I could have expected this. It was time to understand the logic of this WAF. Again, I will just briefly mention it, and the full explanation is on LiveOverflow's channel. I didn't find anything out of place in generating a secret or encryption-decryption functions. What was interesting, however, was that when ciphering, the string encrypted was prepended to the content. Most post and get params were ciphered. Then the decrypt function took the whole response body and deciphered everything that had the string encrypted prepended. So my idea was to get the encrypted input anywhere in the response. Of course, it couldn't be in the node, because then it would simply be encrypted twice. However, there were some inputs that weren't encrypted, and those were very good candidates for this purpose. I quickly scanned the controller for the presence of those first three parameters, but only so UUID used and in the redirect, so I quickly dismissed the idea. I thought, why not create an account with the encrypted flag as the username? And it did work. I created a user using the extracted encrypted flag, and what I saw after the login was the flag from my local environment. So I had the encryption aspect taken care of. Now, how to get this encrypted flag out of the database? At first, I tried the simple union, but it didn't work. It was because union mustn't be after the order clause in SQL query. So this is a blind SQL injection. I couldn't use union, but what I could do is a subquery. That means that you can do arbitrary queries to the database, but you just can't return them as the result. There are many methods which you can use to exfiltrate one bit at a time. And if you can exfiltrate one bit, you can exfiltrate the whole flag after enough time. My idea was to return ascending or descending order using a subquery. So I would check if the first character of the flag is A. If it was, my subquery would return ascending. If it's not, it would return descending. In most SQL databases, there are functions like if and substring that will make it possible. I could easily observe if it's ascending or descending by looking at the response. If it was descending, then I knew that the first character of my flag was not A, so I tried B, C, and so on. After I finally saw the ascending order, I knew the first character of the flag, so I could move on to the second one. I would repeat this until I got the whole flag. Of course, this process is not manual. The problem was, I didn't find a way to return ascending or descending from a subquery, as those are not strings. So then I started to think what can be after the order clause. The answer was the limit clause, which I used at the beginning but then forgot about. It tells the database how many records we want to return. I easily modified my subquery to return 0 or 1 inside the limit clause. It did work locally, however, it's a primitive solution. It generates a lot of traffic. For each character of the encrypted and encoded flag, I needed to send 64 requests in the worst case. Considering the output had the IV, the ciphertext and the auth tag, it could take very long. I think the real flag had about 200 characters. If I were playing the CTF for points, I would likely just leave the script running for a few hours. But I didn't. Instead, I wanted to have a bit more fun. So I decided to create an efficient exploit, especially that I saw that the challenge was yet to be solved by anyone. Usual tricks you can use to speed up blind SQL injection exfiltration are binary search, which reduces it to 6 requests per character, using multiprocessing to brute force many characters at once, or using regexes combining those two techniques. But I knew I could do it even quicker than this. Considering that we are in the limit clause, we are not restricted to returning 0 or 1. It can be any number. My idea was to add 128 nodes and return the amount of nodes equal to ASCII code of the next character of the flag. So when the first character was capital E with ASCII code 69, then my query would return 69 nodes because my limit clause would be 69 as a result of the subquery. To see what was the value of the limit clause, I could just count the amount of nodes in the response. I did overcomplicate this part a bit. Instead of counting nodes, I named them node 0 to node 127, which caused some boring and annoying problems, but I somehow dealt with them. Finally, I successfully tested my script on the local instance and I was ready to smash the live environment. My approach meant that I only needed 128 requests at the beginning to add nodes and then one request per each character of the encrypted flag. It meant that with 200 characters flag, I only needed 328 requests. That's a lot less than 1200 requests of binary search and 12,800 of naive solution. That's the worst case, but even if we take half of that number as an average complexity, my solution was still 95% faster. The server had some latency issues as probably many players were brute forcing simultaneously, but after some time I finally got the flag. Thanks to the fact that I invested a bit more time offline to prepare my exploit, I saved a lot of time online. That's probably the reason why I was the first one to solve the challenge. If you enjoyed the video, make sure to subscribe to the channel. If you want to learn even more from me, join my newsletter and get the best hacking tips delivered right to your inbox. Sign up now for free at mailing.bugbountyexplained.com. For now, thank you for watching and goodbye.